Norwick, and I am delighted to be worshiping with all of you this morning. I welcome to those of you who are here in the pews, those who are watching, and those all who are watching after they get home from the fair today. So we're grateful for all who are here. We have just a couple of announcements this morning before we begin. Does anyone want to start us off? Thank you, Nancy. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to thank all the people who have been working at the fair and also all the people who helped make the pies. And we also thank Rogers Orchards because for 30 years now they've donated the apples so that we can make the pies. So if you're thinking about buying something apple-oriented or baking, head for Rogers Orchards. They support us. We should support them. And in that, we made 129 pies, and we have 8 apple pies left for sale in the parish hall at $15 a pie. So afterwards, if you'd like to buy an apple pie, come see me.
Good morning. I just want to announce that there is a new sign-up genius that is linked to the church website for our coffee hour. So if you are interested in hosting a very simple, did you hear that part? Very simple coffee hour, then you can go to the church homepage and find that sign-up sheet. And we'll have your date available. I know we will, except for next Sunday, when we will celebrate Rally Sunday, welcoming our beginning of our program year, and we will have an ice cream social. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you to everybody that's been working one, two, three, four shifts at the fair. We're still trudging through. We could still use a couple extra bodies this afternoon. We've encountered a few different things this year. We had a vomit spill that we had to clean up. We had somebody that had stitches removed and came back to work, our dedicated workers. We had someone that cut their thumb and had to go get stitches and came back to work. And then we had a power failure. So all our ovens and everything went off. So, but we're still there. We're gonna be there today. So if anybody's available, we need like two or three people that could help us out this afternoon.
Thanks, Judy. I'll take it from you. Thank you.
And now I invite you to begin service this morning by opening our minds and our hearts through music. We will sing the first verse of your insert, "We Have Come Into This House," for our song of invocation. Join me in the call to worship that's printed in your bulletin. God has shown us what is good and what is asked of us in return: to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God. Jesus says, "Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me, and anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." And the Spirit says, "Come, for all are welcome here. The doors of the church are open, open to all whom God has created." God of love and acceptance, open our minds, open our hearts, and open the doors of our lives to you and to others. Please pray with me. Gathered in our sacred spaces, O Creator Spirit, in the multicolored company of your church on earth, we celebrate your creation and invite your presence into our midst. We know, Creator Spirit, that eternity cannot hold you, nor can our little words describe the breadth of your faithfulness to us. Yet, in the space of our small heart, come close and repair us. Bring new life where we are worn and tired. Bring new love where we have turned hard-hearted. Bring forgiveness where we feel hurt and are wounded. May the joy and freedom of your holy presence burst open our once closed minds and hearts and doors. Amen. I invite you now to rise in body or in spirit and join me in our first hymn. You'll find it on page 487 of your pew hymnal.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
I was reading a devotional message one day this week on prayer and giving thanks. The writer referenced the story from Scripture of Jesus feeding the 5,000. However, the perspective was a little bit different. The writer focused on Jesus giving thanks before the meal, something we often overlook in that scripture. But the writer was focused on Jesus giving thanks before the miracle occurred. As we bring our gifts to share, let us give thanks in anticipation of the miracles that God can work with what we have to give. The morning offering will now be received.
What if the healing comes through tears? What if the doubt?
Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for these gifts, knowing that they come from your hand. As we give them back to you to do your work, bless them so that they may bring the miracle of your love to many. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, I expected a quiet morning, and I was right. It's really hard to compete with the Berlin Fair, isn't it? I got some feedback coming. Let's see, am I better? Testing. 1, 2. God, are you there? I'm okay? Okay. So, good morning. Yes. Well, I have to say, I'm not okay. I'm going to use a handheld.
No, it's okay.
Are you sure? Are you sure? Am I good? I think I'm good. Okay. All right. So, this week, when I read the title to our sermon, Refueling Something Something, the refuel part got to me. I immediately thought of a children's message that I did before. And so, gonna, like any good teacher, do a recap. But we're going to go further with it, too. But just in case you weren't here, I do like object lessons. And a lot of times they say, well, object lessons aren't really good for little kids. Well, fortunately, there's no little kids here this morning. So, we come to church on Sunday. And we all come for a variety of reasons, like that extraordinary music we just heard. Yeah. You touched the hearts of every person in this building this morning. And that's one reason we come to church, to get filled up with music and with prayer, listening to God, talking to God, and scripture, listening to God's word to us, and seeing what God has to speak to us on that given morning. And we come for community and to be with our friends here at church and give each other strength and give some strength to those in need. And there's a variety of reasons. And on any given Sunday, people come here for different reasons. And then our week happens. That's what happens during the week. We are depleted, and sometimes that's Monday morning. So, we talked about this before, but I couldn't help of thinking about that little visual when we're talking about being refueled here at church on Sunday morning. So, it's Monday, and we are depleted. How do we recharge ourselves? Are we able to connect with God outside of this building? And if so, how do you connect with God during the week when you are depleted? So a couple things came to mind for me. I love to be outdoors. Many of you know that. And you know that I walk my dog every morning. And about a year ago, I was devastated when I was approached by coyotes and could no longer walk in the woods where I find God and my peace and my solitude. So I had to come up with a new route to walk. And it took a while. I had to explore different roads around my neighborhood. And I've landed on a new road. And it brings me out down onto High Road by the old horse barn, the old horse farm. And on that route, there is a little bridge over the road. I think it's either single bridges or double bridges somewhere that goes down. And with the extraordinary amount of rain that we've had on and off, that little stream has been raging at times, and it's been gently flowing at times. And I noticed something in my 50-some-odd years that I had never noticed before, that when I pass that stream, my body exhales. I stop there sometimes. There's another woman I meet passing many, many mornings, and she stops as well, and she has her little meditation moment as well. Literally, my body just exhales. I feel it in my body. And so there's a connection right there with God in that moment. And many times we're too busy to notice our connection moments with God. And there are many of them throughout the day. And so I'm reminding everyone this morning that we need to be still. And this morning you're going to hear Psalm 46, where we are reminded to be still and know that I am God. And God is giving us signs everywhere outside of this building that God is with us. And I know in that moment when I hear the babbling of the brook or the raging water, that God is there in creation. I see it all the time. And so I'm just wanting to remind you, if you need to refuel outside of this building, and I hope every day you are refueling with God, that you take a moment to be still. Because in the busyness of your lives and all those things, I could do this balloon again, all the things you're doing in the course of one morning and fill it up, and you're gonna crash. And we need to take time to just be still. Because as soon as you are connected and still, you're gonna feel God. You're gonna feel God. I feel God all the time outdoors. But God is also as close as your breath. And I talked about this one time in a children's message, but as I was preparing for this morning, I was reminded that God is as close as our breath. I have been doing a lot of deep breathing recently. I've been doing a lot of breathing exercises with my mom because she has been having trouble finding her breath. And I know as soon as I take a breath in through my nose and let it out through my mouth, maybe two or three times, I am centered with God again. And the thing that I tell my mom, you know, of course you've all heard, smell the roses, blow out the candle, that God is with us at that first breath of birth. And God is with us at the last breath that we take on this earth. And I am just reminded that God is with us everywhere in between when I remember to breathe through it. And so one final thing, this is again the teacher me recapping from that breath message that I did, that if you listen to the sound that you make when you breathe like that, it sounds like Yahweh. It sounds like the name of our God that is too precious to be spoken, who is with us in every moment. So as you need refueling through your week, and you will, hopefully not as soon as Monday morning, but chances are it might come even sooner, I remind you to be still and know that God is with you in every moment, and find the way that you can find God outside of this building. Amen. Let it be so.
Our first scripture reading this morning is the 46th Psalm, and you can find it on page 517 to 518 in the Old Testament section of your pew Bible. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, "Be still and know that I am God." I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Our second scripture reading this morning is found in the second book of Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, and you can find it on page 181 in the New Testament section of your pew Bible. It is written, "Therefore, I believed, therefore I have spoken. Since we have the same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we set and fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Here ends the reading. Please sing with me. Good morning. As some of you may know, I used to drive a Toyota Prius. Now, this homily might resemble a shameless Prius commercial just for a minute, but I promise there's a point to it. For those who have not heard the hype about the Prius and other hybrid vehicles, these cars rely not just on gasoline, but some also on battery, and now some on electricity. And you can just plug your car in. I resisted buying a Prius for a very long time because I was reluctant with the new technology, and mostly because my father, who at that time was working for Toyota, said to wait until many years passed to see how they fared. So as the Prius became Massachusetts state car, which is where I lived at the time, I leaned more and more into the idea and finally got one. And not just one, my partner at the time and I both traded our vehicles in for a Prius. And just as we had hoped, the gas mileage was amazing. And I always was fascinated, catching myself watching the screen as it changes from battery to fuel and back again, how many miles per gallon I could get. Having had a Prius for many years, I found myself in a pattern. You see, I only had to fill up with gas maybe a couple of times a month. So I actually found myself becoming more and more unaware of whether or not I actually needed gas in the car. You know how you usually check your gas gauge to see how much gas you have, to see if you can get to where you're going and get back? Well, I had fallen completely out of that habit of checking it because of how seldom I had to refuel. In fact, my daughters Casey and Sapphire were tasked with peeking at the gas gauge every time we got in the car. The problem with getting into a routine and not checking whether or not we have enough gas is pretty obvious, but I then began to think about an interesting phenomena and question arose. Where else in life do we pay less attention to fuel because we've got swept up in the mechanics of the day-to-day? One of those places I have found some of us is in our relationship with God. The expression of our everyday relationship with God is how we live our lives, how we treat one another, how we make decisions, how we choose to help the rest of the people in this really big and yet really tiny world. Expressions of our faith can become just as mechanical as my Prius. And sometimes we run the risk of being on autopilot in our faith life as well. Think about it. We come to church on Sunday morning to worship God, express our love, fill up on God's grace, mercy, and forgiveness. We meander over for a cup of coffee, saying hi to those we love, and leave church to take on the week with a full tank of gas, and then need to watch that fuel tank is the furthest thing from our mind in this moment. Now, if we were all Priuses, that would be fine. We wouldn't need to come back here and fill up for a couple of weeks even, but alas, none of us are Priuses. None of us operate best when we forget the gas gauge. The battery that's inside of us that we rely on from getting to Sunday or fill up to fill up is constantly overworked. All right, I've played the Prius image a little too long, and I'm sure I've set myself up for a litany of jokes from here on out, asking me if I have enough gas to get home every day, especially since I don't have a Prius anymore. But it's all worth it because my question to us this morning, my beloved church, how can we tell when it's time to refuel? And further, how do we find a gas station? Our scriptures this morning talk about the gift of the Holy Spirit in different ways. Jesus took a little bit of time trying to explain this to his disciples and those who followed him, because let's face it is not easy to wrap our head around the idea that someone in the physical is going to disappear and then come back and live within us and guide us along the way in our lives. It's a very difficult concept for human minds. And though experiences would help us understand it, it doesn't quite paint the picture. So Jesus tried to explain what it meant to his disciples to be filled up. And he explains that God will be sending an advocate for them, someone who will be with them forever, the Spirit of Truth. He goes on to say that this advocate is not one that you can see, per se. It's not one the world can see, per se. It's one that dwells within each of us, helping us navigate through life. Can you hear how gently Jesus is trying to explain this to the disciples? If you have a moment to go and read the 14th chapter of John, it would be worth it. He mentioned his departure a time or two before that and was met with some hostility. And it's getting closer here and closer and closer, and the disciples just don't know what to do with themselves. They can't fathom the idea of going forward without him here in front of them. You see, he was their fuel. He was what helped them navigate through life. He was what gave them purpose and passion and direction. He was what opened their minds to the new way of life, a new way of seeing people, a brand new way of being in close, loving relationship with God and with others. He was fueling their every moment, and the thought of losing him was devastating to them. Jesus recognized that. He knew the actions of humans over the course of all history demonstrated the difference between how we lived when we are fueled by the love of God and how we live when we are running on empty. That is why Jesus said what he said in the first place. Don't we see through the course of the story of the Bible that God recognized the deep and wide disconnect between all whom God created and God? Think how carefully God understood the needs of humanity to help rebuild that relationship. We read in the Old Testament how often God plainly spoke through the prophets and somewhere other than the tangible world. We saw the struggle that humans had to trust in and follow that which they could not see. And so the prophet begins to tell us soon God will manifest God's self here on earth and we will again reunite with Creator as creation. God could have skipped that step, right? God could have easily said, in the future, I will send an advocate, one that will be your guide to guide you along. But I think God knew probably we would not understand. We would not capture it. We would not refuel. But I think, more importantly, God knew we wouldn't be able to fill up in the way that Jesus was able to fill his disciples. So God chose to come cloaked in flesh, becoming one with humanity. God manifested into the form of Jesus to show us how, through human life, what it meant to be in relationship with God. God knew very well that God had to physically demonstrate to us what it looked like to be in relationship with God, what it felt like to be in relationship with God. God knew that we needed to physically see what it was like to walk with God, to talk with God, to learn more about ourselves from God, to experience the world through the eyes of God, to experience the affirmations of those who knew God and the ridicule of those who hadn't felt that love in a very, very long time. All of that was what the disciples experienced, walking with Jesus. The disciples had the real life, tangible experience of what it meant to be in relationship with God for 3 years. And it was coming to the end of those 3 years. And Jesus was trying to explain to them that he would be returning, but in a form different than they could see then. I believe this is why Jesus took such care in trying to explain the Holy Spirit. Think about the theology of the Trinity. It's not easily understood. And I'm beginning to think that maybe because we weren't fully meant to understand it. What we learn from Scripture is that God has the power to manifest God's self in different ways and continues to do so throughout our lives. But this love story that is the Bible concentrates on the three ways in which humanity experiences God. God the Creator, Jesus, the reconciler, and finally, God as Holy Spirit. And I know all of those things sound very, very different, but it is a brilliant way for God to simply come back full circle to how God operates in the first place. Creator God who breathed life into each of our bodies and embedded in the divine spirit that now lives within each of us. Because God's love and tenderness for all whom God created, God who can do all things, came to show us just that. And now we have the blessing of recognizing God, not just within us, but within all things. We have the blessing of being able to read this story and live out what it looks like to refuel, to meet with one another and share the Spirit, not this just that dwells within each of us, but that dwells within those whom we meet. And all of this has taught us that one way to see one another, one way to see God, is the same way that the disciples did, to make sure that we are walking with God and fueling, just like Jesus did. So that brings us back to our question. How do we know if we need to refuel? And where are the gas stations? When the moment-by-moment life that we are all living becomes automatic, we may need to refuel. When we can witness injustice in the world, whether in person or on TV, and not be moved to action, we may need to refuel. When we are unable to look at the face of any other human being and not catch a glimpse of God, we may need to refuel. When our load is so heavy that the thought of giving back is crippling, we may need to refuel. When our decisions are not filled with thoughtfulness and wider consideration, we may need to refuel. When the thought of entering into a time of prayer is daunting, we may need to refuel. When our vision is solely based on what we can see with our eyes, we may need to refuel. Perhaps I've given us some room to think about other times in life that makes us wonder, do we need to refuel? Maybe as we look back on this past week and identify a time or two where we were that balloon that fizzled under the pew. Maybe we are even realizing that I'm not going to make it to the end of the day without needing to refuel. And if that's the case, where are our gas stations? As much as I would love to hold a worship service, anyone, anytime needs to refuel, I can't do that for you. But more importantly, I would be doing you a huge disservice by making Sunday morning worship our only source of fuel. This is not what your pastor is for. Pastor's job and joy, church, is to offer a space for all of us to worship God and bring the love and message of God into the world. But mostly, I'm here to remind you that God lives within each and every one of us. And all we need to do to refill is call out for God. Entering into prayer is a gas station. Gathering to Bible study is a gas station. Coming together for choir, it's a gas station. Working the Berlin Fair together, as exhausting as it is a gas station. Opening up that love story that is the Bible and reading those scriptures, that is a gas station. Helping others, reaching out to those in need, baking cookies for fellowship, singing Amazing Grace to your baby in the middle of the night. All gas stations, my friends. Just as Jesus was trying to show his disciples that they are never without God, God is continually reminding us of the very same thing. Our lives were never meant to live on autopilot. We were built to be a hybrid of spirit and humanity. We are creatures created to be fueled by not just bread, but the bread of life. Not just water, but the living water. Not just life, but the spirit that lives within each and every one of us in all moments, for all things, because when we see things differently when we are fueled. I know that the days can blend together. I know we can't always come and fuel up here at KCC, but the good news is that God is not only found here in this beloved place, but God is infused throughout this whole amazing world. All we need to do is take a look at our gas gauge and stop for fuel. Amen. At this time, we have the opportunity to share our joys and concerns this morning.
Good morning. I'm Gwen McCann,
And I just want to share a joy that my mom is home in her condo with a lot of extra assistance with a new aide. And her spirits seem to be a little bit lighter and brighter right now. So I'm very, very overjoyed about that. And she is still happy to receive cards and perhaps visits. It's hard to catch her with dialysis, and she doesn't always hear the phone ring, but I'm so happy because I visited her this morning, and she was in good spirits. She had great color, and these are all things that were kind of lacking in the past weeks. So thank you for your prayers.
As Susan is making her way over, I want to lift up continual prayers over Bob Bauman and continual prayers over Judy as she recovers and as Alan recovers.
Hi, I'm Erin Ferris. I'm asking for continued healing prayers. My best friend Kira unexpectedly lost her dad about a year ago, and it's been a long, hard year.
And Chris Gates Winook, and I'm going to ask for prayers for all the people who have put in so much work and so many hours to the Berlin Fair. And I'm going to mention a couple of people by name. I know they don't want to be mentioned, but Judy Cefalato and Wendy Kingsbury and many other people who have worked multiple shifts and are going back again today. And they have done really a tremendous job, and I'm sure they're going to just drop, and they'll need to be refueling tonight. But anyway, thank you so much to all those people that have put in so much love and effort to the fair. And wow, how wonderful. We've had so many people come into the booth, and the spirit in there when I've been there has been so positive, and I think it's been wonderful for the community to see just how great all of the members of our church are and how filled with spirit we are. So kudos to everybody who's had any part in the fair.
Good morning, everyone. Lynn Furman. I just wanted to ask for continued prayers for our family and thank you for what you have held up for us. And Bill is having a rheumatologist look at him tomorrow after much time of constant pain. And we just ask for your special prayers for that and for Nancy and Nick and for Susan's family, who we know this week has had loss of her mom, Grace. And just thank you so much for the welcome that we've had at the church and how much we just love being here. Have a wonderful day.
As soon as Susan is making her way back, I want to lift up a joy. The Jasinski family welcomed Cameron Michael Jasinski this past weekend. So their family of three has become a family of four. And just as our friend Lynn reminded us, Susan lost her mom, Grace, this past week. Prayers over Susan and her family. And as you can see in the bulletin, her name is Grace. Yes.
One further thing, we have to say happy birthday to our church organist and music director.
Oh, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear Corey. Happy birthday to you.
How'd we do? We harmonized. Please pray with me. Almighty God, we know that we often move through the day to day without stopping to fill up on your peace and your love. We come to worship, to sing your praises, to hear your word, and then move into the rest of the week without refueling on your spirit. Open us up to your presence in this time of worship, in our lives, in our everyday, and in the world. Quiet our busy thoughts and distracted attention so that we can be still and know that you are God. Through Jesus, our Redeemer, who topples the dividing walls by the power of your Holy Spirit, we ask this and all things in the words that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit. Join me in our last hymn. You'll find it on page 442 in your pew hymnal. As filled as we may feel, we will need to refuel. Join me as we learn to find our gas stations. Amen.